Hello, hello, everybody. It is 11:12 p.m. Central Time, still on the 16th of July, 2020. It's Thursday still here in the United States, and it is now Friday internationally. But we've got some still breaking big news. A 7.0 range earthquake has struck over in the West Pacific. You can see me here on the camera just for a second, but we're going to get out of here and we're going to jump over and take a look at where the earthquake stands now. Both agencies now have the event at 7.0, which, again, that's going to go up or down. When it goes down to 6.9, of course, I complain. But here we are, 7.0. There are buoys now in event mode, but apparently the tsunami warning was lifted, or at least that was a report from people in chat while it was premiering over on YouTube. So I guess we just need to go check everything. Let's go to tsunami.gov first. So tsunami.gov. All right. Already still have it on the list right here. No tsunami warning, advisory, watch, or threat. So they've taken it down from threat down to nothing, which is good. We want to see that happen. So that's good news. Now, that being said, let's go see what the NDBC says. Because the NDBC is showing us buoys, they go into event mode when we have actual shaking detected too. So when they're shaking and shifting detected, the buoys go into event mode. When there's a wave, buoys go into event mode, but they're different type of events. So let's go in and just take a quick look and show you how to look at this. So when we're looking at this, this is our regular day-to-day activity. You know, we get ebbs and flows in the normal tidal flow. Once we get right down here to the bottom of here, it has like a little red line. You can barely see it on this graph. We click on View Event Details, it'll blow it up for us so we can see it a little bit bigger. Two different views on it. So here's a semi-blow-up view of it. Here's our normal wave activity. And then here's the incoming shaking of the actual earthquake detected. It looks like a mini earthquake, basically. Going through the buoy itself, buoy tethered to the seafloor, seafloor actually getting the earthquake. Coming up through the buoy, sensitive enough to detect it. There it is. And you can look in even closer on that, and you'll see it, the impact of it and everything like you would normally see in an earthquake. So it's not a tsunami. That's good news, right? Okay, so it's an earthquake detected on one of the buoys. Now, let me take you to the overall map, and we've seen big, deep earthquakes, for instance. We had a big, deep 8 that happened 2 years ago. And a bunch of buoys all the way around the entire Pacific went into event mode on that big deep 8. So here's one right next to or across from where the earthquake developed. And now let's go look up the info from the USGS. Okay, so we're going to go over to their map first, and we're going to turn on the plate boundaries. Tectonic plates. This is a map I consult regularly. You need to look at it too, where the red lines are. That's where the plate boundaries are between the different plates. Where the star is, that's where the earthquake has developed. And, of course, it's right on the plate boundary. This is somewhat normal in the West Pacific in particular. Okay, and we watch for this here to have an effect in the area in the next few days as this spreads out. Now, what spreads out might be the question a lot of people might ask if they're not new, or if they're new here and they don't know. We had a big, deep earthquake 10 days ago. Right here on the north side of Java, very far down below the West Pacific, hundreds of miles down below. In addition to that, we had a series of other deep earthquakes, which you can see raised high off the globe here. For instance, I'll take you up here to Japan, a deep 5 and a deep 4.1 right on our letter D. Letter D stands for deep earthquakes. We have another letter D right here in Indonesia, and right next to it, we have another deep 5 point something, I think it was at 5.7. Over to the east, we have a letter D at Fiji, and let's just go back 2 days. Take a look. Series of deep earthquakes developing right in the middle of that letter D. Each letter D is a pre-designated point where we watch for new deep earthquakes to strike. When those deep earthquakes happen, then leverage basically forms on the underside of the plate. Let's go back to the USGS plate boundary map. Leverage forms on the underside of the plate, and we have cracks through the plate that go up to the surface and go all the way down to the bottom of the plate, right to an area called the asthenosphere. Now that's just a complex geologist term to describe the lowest point below the plate itself. We have the lithosphere, the plate, we have the asthenosphere, and then we go down into the mantle, which is all liquid magma. So the asthenosphere is semi-melted, and that's where the earthquakes are happening down below. Over here, and over here, and up here in Japan. So leverage down below comes up through the plate, and we get a shallower, larger earthquake up at the surface in the rigid plate. You gotta remember, it's coming out of a fluid, the magma. This power or force, think of a wave crashing against a rock. Over time, it'll break down the rock. Well, there's already a break through the rock. Think of it like this, a wave crashing against a wall that already has a crack in it, a big one. So of course, the water is going to make its way through that crack. And in this case, we're talking about a force or a power coming up the same way, but it's coming up from underneath. Now a middle point is found. This is the most amazing discovery of everything that I've found online so far and everything that I've done in my own work. This is the most amazing geophysics discovery, that when the force comes up through a plate or travels through the plate, a natural sorting process takes place. A fulcrum point. Think of a two-arm scale where you have weight on one side and weight on the other. And the middle point, that middle point is where the weight accumulates and is balanced or measured. But Mother Nature is finding these middle fulcrum points across areas that are not perfectly straight. They're bent and jagged and twisted edges of a plate that goes across thousands of miles. Yet Mother Nature is still sorting out that middle fulcrum point, that balance point between the areas that are being leveraged up. So a big earthquake has struck here. 10 days ago, on July 6th, we issued the warning for this big earthquake to strike, most likely from here to here. This was our main warned area. Then we went north up into Indonesia and Japan for 6.0 level activity. And I'd say we weren't let down. A new deep 5 and several eruptions have taken place, but we're going to see new 6.0 level activity develop between our current sets of earthquakes. Now that the 7 has shown up on day 10 of the 10-day watch, we watch from this point for the next 7 days for this to spread out and away. Okay, so as we look at this, we have to go over to Asia. We have to go over to the United States. We have to go over to Central America. And we have to determine the areas that are between the sets of current earthquakes. Now, there's a lot of areas that have been hit, but I look between the overall areas that are moving. So, for instance, we have a 5.8 here to the north and a series of 4s and eruptions. Down to the south, a series of 4s spanning all of South America. We look between the two, right here, where the 4s meet the 5. We watch there for a similar-sized earthquake to what just struck here in the next 7 days. We've seen this happen enough where 7 strikes in the West Pacific, followed shortly thereafter, within a few days, by something of similar size from Central America into South America. It's happened at least 4 times where we've had 7.0 range activity, where followed up within days, we have new 7.0 level activity over to the east. Hold tight 1 second, guys. Got a little message buzzing in here. Hold on. People are telling me to check Twitter. Okay, all right, thank you for the tip off there, guys. Check Twitter of all things. Oh my God, okay, well, Twitter, okay. Twitter, here we come. Come along with me on a voyage of no discovery, but more like social media discovery, which really isn't. Let's search Papua New Guinea. Let's see what comes up. Okay, we've got AP. Hazardous tsunami waves possible. Let's go to the latest and see if that's going to bring up anything. Breaking news sources. Of course, wow, they're really spamming that. Look at that. Okay. Tsunami warnings, of course, dominate the news, but I was told to look for... Actually, hey, look, people are sharing my video. God bless your heart. McClure808, whoever you are. First time I've ever seen my stuff in a search. And, okay, well, I don't think I'm going to find it. What I was told to look for was shaking videos that were coming up on Twitter, but I'm not seeing those. It's buried by mainstream news. Look at this, guys. I could just keep scrolling for 20 years and we'll probably never find a video at this point. I could go back up and click on videos. Maybe that would help. But getting a tip off to check that, so check videos. Maybe they were just telling me to check videos. Well, I'm not seeing much. Okay, people telling me to check videos. Maybe they were just asking me to. It's starting to look like that's what it is. Okay, so nothing on social media. Maybe that's what they wanted me to see. That there's nothing on social media about this. Except for mainstream news, blah, blah, blah. Okay, well, that's troubling. But I guess also we can expect that on northern Papua New Guinea. But hey, this is heavily populated just over to the east. There are larger cities over here on the island. So thousands of people, and they do have internet there. I'm 100% on that. Okay, well, you know, thank you for the tip-off, but I guess there's nothing to find, so... Or it's getting buried. You know what? It's probably shadow banned. You guys see the news on Twitter? Oh, man. What else is going on? Hey, check this out. North Italy up here right next to... Is this right next to Croatia? A new mid-range forest just popped off Slovenia. Slovenia. We're right next to Slovenia. A new 4-point-something just rattled Central Europe, guys. That is right along the plate boundary. Looks like things are in motion. You know, I'm not too shocked by that with all the deep earthquake activity. Here's another example. Take a look at this. Do you see the earthquakes here? We're just talking 4.0 level activity, so it's not like we're talking huge earthquakes here right now. But 4.0, 4.0, 3.8, 3.1. We go back in a crescent shape like this. Do you see that? Well, I just showed you the red line map from the USGS. So maybe I should show it to you again. Hold on. Well, I guess we need to open a USGS reported earthquake first. And let's do the same thing. Let's turn on the tectonic plate boundaries. What I want you to see here is that crescent shape of earthquakes that I showed you matches perfectly this, the plate boundary. But the distance on that is almost about the distance, half the United States, you'd say. Same area. I mean, we're talking 1,500 miles, almost 2,000 miles, all moving on a near 4.0 basis, equal distantly spaced apart in the past few hours. Before the 7, now this new earthquake has just filled in that middle fulcrum point that I was telling you about. That two-arm scale where there's a balance point between the two. You have an earthquake here and an earthquake here. And in between the two, if you go around the bend of the plate, that almost perfect middle fulcrum point has just been sorted out by Mother Nature, dropping off earthquakes along the way. Now, what I think is going on here is very complex. It's, I think, a standing wave, where the same-sized waves develop out across an area like a wave pool. This would be the pool, though. Instead of it being the ocean, we're talking about the plate boundary. Okay, that gets really science-y. Sorry, guys, standing waves and so forth. Solitons. Waves of translation. But a 7.0 earthquake is nothing to scoff at. A 10-day warning is nothing to ignore. And anybody who said earthquakes could not be forecast was incorrect. Now, I'm not trying to stoke up a fight with anybody online. I'm just here to tell you that deep earthquakes cause shallower, larger earthquakes usually. And usually within 7 to 10 days. Now, we could probably get into the why on that, which I think ties into VLF. And SLF, very low and super low frequency. Almost like the radio waves that go through the sky, but we're talking about down in the ground. So kind of different, of course, but operating in the same way, which is amazing. But where's the VLF coming from?
The core of the Earth.
Emanating up from the core of the Earth, up through the mantle, up through the asthenosphere, and actually even coming out of the faults themselves. Those red lines that I've showed you on the USGS plate boundary map. Right here in Nepal, there was a very large earthquake several years ago. Maybe 5 years ago, there was an extremely large earthquake here. And it moved Mount Everest, the earthquake did. Tens of thousands of people were also killed in that earthquake. Now, they detected VLF, very low frequency, coming up through the plate boundary here. And it was detected up in the ionosphere, up in space. So a wave was coming from far down below, hundreds of miles down, some kind of VLF wave, which you could say was like radio waves, but it was coming up, peaking up high enough, the wave height going up 1,000 kilometers up into the ionosphere, and then coming, or not 1,000 kilometers, 100 kilometers up into the ionosphere, and then going back down and coming back up and going back down, and imagine a giant wave like in a wave pool, but emanating up from the center of the Earth. So what's generating VLF down inside of the Earth? Well, there's only one thing in nature that generates VLF naturally. Plasmas, like the Northern Lights, for instance, up in the North Pole when the sun barrages the planet with charged particles, we get Northern Lights. The Northern Lights, of course, glowing from electric, basically electric air glow in the air, charged particles. But that goes down to ground. Well, the same thing is happening down, I think, in the core of the Earth. But it's vaporized metal instead of particles in the upper atmosphere and ionosphere. Amazing stuff. So we get back over here, and we have a big deep earthquake 10 days ago. 10 days ago, big deep earthquake, now followed by a 7.0 earthquake coming up in between our sets of current deep earthquakes. And you could say that is a perfect middle point between these two sets of deep earthquakes sticking high off the globe. And if you find that third triangulated point, well, there's an open area here. And we have a warning going now for the next 6 to 7 days for Okinawa going into South Ryukyu Islands, Kyushu, mainly right here in the middle. And it should go into the upper sixth level. The good news I have for everybody is this seven is not deep. It's shallow. It's up towards the surface. So as the energy spreads out following the arrows, let's get all the other smaller earthquakes out of here. As the energy spreads out, it should follow the arrows, first of all, but it will diffuse. It'll be absorbed slightly by the red lines, the plate boundaries. So we're not coming up from below the plate here. We're spreading out in the plate here. This is where it came up. So now it's going to spread to the north, go around the bend to the east, to the west, re-pool off the coast of Japan, go up to Kamchatka, come over across into Alaska, and ultimately reach over to the United States within the next week. But by the time it gets here to the United States, we should have something like an upper five, if they even report it, strike out here off the coast, most likely Southwest Oregon, Northwest California. But the last time I warned for that, it actually six hit up here. Now, we haven't seen a spread like this in several months' time. So it's taken 10 days for the energy to come up over here. Should take the remainder 7 days, or less now, actually 6.5, to go up and around and over into the U.S. So I would expect by this time next week, I will be reporting on something striking out here off the coast. Something bigger than what we've seen in the past several months. At least here. Okay, so we've seen other bigger earthquakes, for instance, up to the north and down to the south. For instance, the 6.5 over in the California-Nevada border, the 6.5 striking up here in Idaho, the 5.7 to 6.0 earthquake at the bunker facility down here at Great Salt Lake. Those are just a few. We had another 6 strike down here by Ridgecrest, and 1 year ago, almost exactly, well, actually a year and a week, we had our 7.0 earthquake, the biggest in 20 years, in South California. Okay, so we're not looking for that now. We're looking for something in the upper 5 range to make its way over here, hopefully, if I got this right. But the bigger activity should pop off equidistantly spaced here, 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 here. You see? I mean, it's just a basic rough estimation right now based upon this. So if we go equidistantly spaced to our open areas, that's where the sixes are going to strike. Then, to top it all off, that new seven should also strike, or something close to it. I mean, don't fault me if it comes in at 6.9. But here, next to Colombia, North Ecuador. But I would say Colombia more has to be the country that's warned. Now, it should strike out in the ocean, which might generate another tsunami warning. Back and forth, like a tennis match, guys. These, by the way, these are the superhighways by which the force transfers across. The fracture zones. They're equal distantly spaced almost, aren't they? Like rungs on a ladder, or latitude on a map almost, right? Once we get down to the equator, there's a crescent shape of volcanic formations and undersea mounts that connect down in a crescent shape and meets up with South America. You see this? Maybe I need to zoom in a little. Here? Okay, we can follow that back. Look, it's a definitive line of volcanoes. And it goes back up and meets with the Hawaiian island chain that branches off and goes out here and dead ends into Hawaii. But look, it connects further up to Kamchatka. So really, you have to look at it like this. From Kamchatka, down, branching off to Hawaii like a side chute, but carrying on. Down to the south, over and across, like a giant letter C. And everything east of the letter C has these equal distance spaced fracture zones, doesn't it? Going down to the south. Once we get down south of this bend like a letter C or crescent shape, we still have equal distantly spaced fracture zones, but then they have themselves again into quarters, have the quarters into eighths, have the eighths into sixteenths, and they just get smaller and smaller, having each other. It's an equal distribution of force. Everything east of all of these volcanoes has an equal distance spaced fracture zone. Everything west, there's just two. They go across American Samoa right here, and they meet back up with where all of our deep earthquakes originate, on our letter D. Okay, so these are like superhighways for the energy to transfer across. And if we get a big disturbance here, well, look where this goes. One of the only two that come across, look where it goes. So, should transfer across. But once we get to Leviathan right here, you'll see a series of stair-step fracture zones. They're kind of hard to see on this map. They go north to south. Jagged edges. Now we need to go back over to the USGS plate boundary map because you can see it better over here. Or wait, let me go this way. There we go. So into South America right here, there they are. This is the plate boundary going over to the east, but it's broken apart into three points. So if energy is coming across here and it gets to here, it's going to go down to here and look where that leads us. Kind of like an arrow pointing into the spot that I just told you to watch. So on one side of the plate, we get a disturbance. The other side of the plate, we get a disturbance. But wait, look where this goes. Goes up to the north, doesn't it? Also goes over to the east, doesn't it? Now you don't see a connection point here, but if this moves, of course, this is going to move. And down to the south. The red line's going to move along the plate here. And then that gets us into next week's forecast. So I don't want to get too far ahead of myself, but here we are. The earthquake has hit the warned area, the warned region. This was one of the areas in the warned region. And it's one of the first sevens to strike here, I think, in many months' time. So many months it's been since this location has been hit with a near seven. And it's the middle fulcrum point. Don't forget the volcano there. To top this all off, Kettovar Volcano. Let's go over and show it to you. Let me get a sip of my coffee, because it's going to be a long night. Okay, there's Bam Bam and Blup Blup Volcano. And these are legit names from the Smithsonian. Blup Blup and Bam Bam. Those are the names given by the islanders, guys. I'm not joking. But here's Kettovar. Kettovar had not erupted in 1,000 years. It came back alive 2 years ago. And I have to take back everybody to, let's see. Yeah, 2 years ago, when I issued a warning for a 7.5 earthquake to strike right here on the north coast, I actually issued the warning for right here at the border. North coast of Papua New Guinea for 7.5. That week, no 7.5 hit. Instead, this volcano suddenly blew up, Kettovar, after 1,000 years silence. We were all shocked, including me. I'm like, did I just forecast an eruption? Because I don't normally do any kind of forecasting involved with volcanic blasts. I leave that to the volcanologist. But there is a formula to this, that when the deep earthquake strike down below the West Pacific, again using that lever arm action that I've been talking about, it leverages on the underside of the plate. And guess what's nestled into the underside of the plate? Plates. The magma chambers. So if you're going to leverage on the underside of something, of course it's going to compress the magma chamber. And if you have an ancient volcano there that's filled up still down below, it could blow. Just pretty simple stuff, right? Pretty simple physics involved with that. So Kettovar came back alive this past week. It had not been on the list for a long time. Many months. So let's go down the list now and see what's happening on the Volcanic Ash Advisory Center list. Epico volcano in the Kuril Islands. Let's see, a 10,000-foot eye blast. What I'm going to look for are any big blasts or any new volcanoes on the list. Semeru, another 14,000-foot eye blast. Let's see. Sanjay, Sabancaya, Nishinoshima again. Fuego is back on the list from Guatemala. Cadovar, up to 5,000 feet. Oh, no, wait. That's a 500-foot. That's a small little blast from... Wait. Hold on. Raung. Raung volcano. I've never had to report on this. Raung volcano, flight level 110. Let's just call it 11,000 foot high blast in Indonesia. Have you guys ever heard of Raung? Do you ever recall us having to report on Raung? I do not recall. So let's go see where it is. Inquiring minds want to know. No, we have a new volcano showing up on the list right next to where the big earthquake just struck. Look, we're not going that far from Papua New Guinea. Raung. Probably butchering the way that's said. Raung, one of Java's most active volcanoes, is a massive stratovolcano in easternmost Java that was constructed southwest of the rim Lean Caldera. I do not recall having to report on Raung volcano. People in the chat room are all saying no. When's the last eruption? Eruptive history. 2015, February. Ah, I started my live stream in March. I started my live stream in March of 2015. It's been 5 years of streaming, but... Okay, so the last eruption was 5 years ago. One of the most regular? One of the most regular would be Semeru or Ibu or... Oh boy, okay, anyway. Mount Dukono? That's a regular. So, 5 years it's been since this volcano erupted right over here. Oh wait, by the way, the location. Eastern Java, in between Bali and Java, which is my warned location now that's going still. So, I talked about this in my previous update no more than an hour ago. I issued the warning. I said between Bali and Java. But there's a volcano there erupting, so let's just go ahead and cancel that right now. Since a volcano is erupting that we've not seen on the list in 5 years, I'll say that does count, though, as a release in the middle of the fulcrum point right here, right where both sets of rings overlap. So I'm glad I checked the list. Okay, let's keep going down the list, see if anybody else is on there. Ibu, of course, these are all in Indonesia. Oh, what we're looking for are any standout volcanoes of big blasts or volcanoes we don't normally see. Suwanizajima's back in South Japan and Kyushu. Okay, well, this is a good wrap-up on the event. A large earthquake has struck. Originally came in at 7.3 to 7.1, and depending on which agency you go to. Then they both took it down to 6.9, then one brought it up to 7, then the other brought it up to 7. So we'll leave it at a 7. No tsunami was generated, and no videos on Twitter, which is suspect. That is censorship. If there's no videos of a big earthquake in Asia, even in Papua New Guinea, I just get a little bit suspicious. Not that the earthquake didn't happen, but that it's, of course, there's not showing us what's going on. Oh boy, do you guys have an earthquake plan? This is day 10 of the 10-day watch. We now have a 7-day watch going based upon this one striking for the other locations to get hit. This goes all the way over to the United States. Look, once we get an upper 5 to near 6 or bigger to strike out here off the coast, or even if it's smaller, we'll say a mid-range 4 to 5.0 earthquake strikes, it's still going to have an effect inland, here in the United States, particularly in California, and going down to the California-Nevada border, where we have a warning going here. Now, the warning for California technically expires today, but because the 7 finally showed up over here today on day 10, I think we're just running a few days behind, guys, so we're going to keep the warning going at Bishop for the next 4 days. 4 days puts us to the 20th, which is 4 days beyond what I would normally watch. But because it's just taking just the ever so slight longer, Mother Nature doesn't work on my time schedule. I work on hers, and I'm trying to get it down to a 7-day to 10-day time frame for my warning purposes. So if we show up on day 10, We have to watch for the next several days. Going over to California, don't let your guard down at Bishop. And we have a warning going from upper 6 to low 7 to strike over here in California. At Bishop, north of Ridgecrest, which is right here near the Nevada border. Okay, so get the word out on that. I hope I'm wrong. Hope nothing hits. But we should see 6s pop off all the way up through Japan, going to Okinawa, then going up to Hokkaido, North Kuril Islands, then going up here to Kamchatka, then going over to Alaska, out here next to Kodiak, then going down here on the coast of the United States. It's going to be a busy week. I'm drinking my coffee now because I'm expecting something to pop off here. I mean, you can see a line of earthquakes spanning out of the West Pacific right now. It's probably a good idea just to keep watch for the next several hours going, you know, here's another spot I didn't even talk about. Do you see how the 4.0 earthquake here in Sumatra? And then we go all the way over here and we have a 4 and a 4.8. Now, if we go over here and around and down, you'll see that this is like a balance point. It's like that middle fulcrum point of a scale. We go back over to the USGS plate boundary map. Let's go look at it this way. Over at Myanmar. Whoops. Boy, I hate it when their map does that. Like, doesn't want to zoom in on a spot. Oh, boy. Okay, there we go. So going over to Myanmar, we have earthquake here in Sumatra. We have earthquakes here up at Afghanistan, North Pakistan, North India border region. That's the plate boundary, the fracture in the plate that starts at the surface and goes all the way down to the underside of the plate. So this power or force is traveling up from the underside of the plate and spreading out through the plate, follows this like a river. And then the scale principle or the fulcrum principle takes place, and we have to warn the people in China going out of Myanmar into China. How big? Should be in the upper 5 range. I think it would be just a little bit smaller than what goes up to Japan at Okinawa. I think most of this should stick in the West Pacific. Go up and around and out, then travel up and out over to the west, over towards Europe. But that's still pretty big for China. When anytime they get 5s or upper 5s or low 6s, it's enough to cause major damage over here. It's a very rigid portion of the plate in the Himalayan range over to the east, and they got a lot of cities over there now. It's not like it's super rural. There's a lot of people that live there. And with things that are going on now, you know, I mean, it's the last thing anybody needs, right? So we just need to let them know if you know anybody over there, okay? Oh, wow. All right. Let me sign off one more time and just tell you, have an earthquake plan. Please take the time to develop an emergency kit, clothes, shoes, first aid kit, sanitation. Oh, look, I'm getting shut off. I'm on a fiber optic connection, so no worries. We'll shut it all down and carry on. I'm just reminding everybody, don't be scared. You need to be prepared. I'm drinking my coffee. I'm saving this as a video, and I will upload this over to YouTube as well so people can just get a better feel for what's going on around the plate. If you live over in Europe, hey, hold on. Hold on. I was just going to talk about the Earth. Just mentioned the 4 here. Look at this. So Slovenia at the Italy border was hit right next to Austria. Now a new 4 has struck right on our arrow going out of Poland, a new 4. So now we have 2 4s in Europe in the past 40 minutes. Okay, well, Europe's moving, following the arrows perfectly, by the way. Hey, people over in Twitch, thank you so much for your support. People are gifting over on Twitch. If you guys are watching, if you watch on YouTube, you can go over and watch on Twitch. Doesn't cost anything. You can watch for free. People might gift you a subscription. I'll be back if anything else goes down, guys. Peace out.